As far back as I can remember, gangster films have always been celebrated. It's not just that the genre is popular, but it's also produced some of the most acclaimed and iconic movies in cinema history. But the gangster film has changed a lot over the last 100 years. The traditional gangster narrative was largely established by Warner Brothers in the 1930s. These were rise and fall narratives, where a young man ascends from poverty through a glamorous life of crime before everything crumbles. These characters were rebellious outlaws who showed a flagrant disregard for authority and thrived in a Depression-era economy. Echoes of these anti-heroes can be felt in the new Hollywood, as a new generation of filmmakers reinterpreted the rise and fall of the gangster with more modern filmmaking techniques. But this formula has largely fallen out of favor in recent decades. Modern gangster films are typically just as concerned with the cops hunting the criminals as they are the criminals themselves. Otherwise, they're stylized heist movies, which focus more on one particular job rather than the sweeping scope of something like Scarface. Even when a modern crime film does have this sense of scope and a similar rise and fall narrative, the setting and social milieu is pretty far removed from the elegance and prestige of The Godfather. How did gangster films change from morally ambivalent profiles of romanticized outlaws to distancing themselves from the mafia lifestyle? What happened? This guy, Sergio Leone. Leone made his name in spaghetti westerns, where he was no stranger to deconstructing the myths of genre. What started as moral ambiguity and intense violence in his Dollars trilogy eventually evolved into a critique of the American expansion and enterprise at the heart of the Western in Leone's Once Upon a Time in the West. By the time of his last Western, Duck, You Sucker, Leone was questioning the very notion of Western heroism and the efficacy of political revolution. Each of these films took a hard look at the morals and values embedded within the Western and considered the violence and brutality which underpinned them. But with his final film, Leone would move from one American myth to another. Once Upon a Time in America is a dark mirror of the classic gangster archetype, capturing all of the genre's elements and tropes, while also revealing the horrific violence which underlies them. No longer a rebellious antihero or romantic ideal, the gangster of Once Upon a Time in America is a vicious and vile scumbag, purely concerned with his own desires and loyal to nothing else. The film is an evisceration of the American gangster, demonstrating the innate brutality which had always existed within the genre, as well as the hollowness of the gangster's life. In doing so, the film effectively killed the American gangster movie as it was once known, and the genre has never really been the same. But to really understand the ways in which Once Upon a Time in America killed the gangster, we're gonna need to understand the history the film emerged from. This video will explore the origins of the archetypical gangster movie, how the genre evolved in subsequent decades, and finally, analyze how Leone built on the bones of the classic gangster film while also refuting their fundamental ideals. So get comfortable because it's going to be a long video. Part 1, the 1930s. Crime movies date back to the silent era, with a string of films depicting dangerous urban environments where impoverished characters are embroiled in a life of crime. But the gangster film as a clearly defined genre didn't really pick up traction until the talkies. There were some early precedents, like The Doorway to Hell, but it was the 1-2 punch of Warner Brothers' Little Caesar and The Public Enemy in 1931 that established the American gangster as a cinematic archetype, an archetype reaffirmed a year later with Howard Hawks' Scarface. All three films were major successes critically and financially, and in turn set the standard for gangster movies. The major traits of the genre popularized by this trio of films are as follows. The gangster story is a rise and fall narrative, where the gangster emerges from a lower class background, and is often an immigrant, but achieves a twisted version of the American dream through a life of crime, acquiring wealth, status, and power. The road to success is paved with battles against the cops, but also rival gangs, with the conflict between other gangs suggesting a contest of skill and intelligence. Crucially, the gangsters are all men, and the world of the gangster is very much a boys' club. Women are relegated to secondary players at best, and are often objects for male consumption, as well as symbols of status. The Public Enemy emphasizes this no girls allowed mentality the most, with flashbacks linking Tom Power's contempt for women as an adult to his immaturity as a child. Finally, the gangster film is a viciously violent story about a viciously violent man. These films are in fact infamous for pushing the limits of the newly written production code. Crucially though, this violence was couched in an intense loyalty to a brotherhood. The gangster may be violent, but he also has a deep love for his brothers in arms. This loyalty is in fact the cause of the greatest violence, either when the loyalty is betrayed, or to avenge a fallen brother. This sense of loyalty, of a code of morality that transcends law, helps make the gangster more sympathetic. And that's the thing. Despite the protests of Will Hayes, these movies were sympathetic to the gangster. Depression-era audiences were expected to identify with the lower-class backgrounds of the gangster, and could relate to their anti-authority attitude in the face of mass financial collapse and institutional failure in the United States. The gangster offered a power fantasy, wherein impoverished Americans could escape from societal fringes and achieve glamour and wealth. There were production code-inspired efforts to diffuse this glamour, in the form of title cards denouncing the gangster lifestyle, and endings where the gangster is punished and killed for their societal transgressions. Ostensibly, these were stories that condemned the criminal lifestyle. In practice, however, these films celebrated the glory and accomplishment of organized crime. A brief coda saying, "Actually, crime is bad," does not compare to the thrill of watching Tom Powers ascend in the criminal underworld. The deaths of Rico Bandello or Tony Camonte don't make their lives any less glamorous. Quite the opposite, in fact. The gangster's death helps make him immortal. A larger-than-life figure who was too bold and reckless for this world. He refused to yield to the expectations of society, and instead went down in a blaze of glory. On paper, these films may have condemned the gangster, but the message which resonated was far more celebratory. The gangster film would reach an apex at the end of the decade with The Roaring Twenties, where the gangster's death is imbued with religious imagery, suggesting a tragic martyr rather than a lowly criminal. But in the 1940s, the gangster would take a backseat to a new type of crime story. Part 2. Film noir and the heist movie. Warner Brothers would reinvent the crime film again in 1941 with The Maltese Falcon, ushering in film noir. There were certainly major noir precedents prior to The Maltese Falcon, including an earlier adaptation of Dashiell Hammett's novel in 1931. But it was John Huston's classic that helped popularize many of the dominant noir tropes, like chiaroscuro lighting, emphasized camera angles, and a narrative built on a convoluted mystery. Film noir shifted away from the gangster protagonist, and instead foregrounded an investigator who gradually uncovers deep layers of crime and corruption. In The Maltese Falcon, this investigator is privatized Sam Spade, an archetype who would be echoed again and again. But noir investigators also became police officers, insurance agents, novelists, and even Hollywood screenwriters. These protagonists were typically anti-heroes with a gray moral compass, but ultimately good guys, who often sought out to help people and usually tried to do the right thing. They may have been a little dirty, but they were certainly a lot cleaner than the gangster protagonists of the 1930s. Over the next two decades, film noir would become the dominant mode of crime film in America. Huston's crime narrative innovations would not end with The Maltese Falcon. His 1950 film, The Asphalt Jungle, helped birth the heist film. Like the classic gangster films, heist movies typically revolve around criminals, but the narrative shy away from the epic, decade-spanning sweep of something like The Public Enemy. Instead, these stories revolve primarily around one job, with the focus being on the extensive planning and eventual execution of a robbery. These movies were tinged with a sense of fatalism, where fools see their elaborate plans crumble before their eyes, and they also rejected the glamorous aesthetic of the classic gangster film, instead embracing a more hard-boiled and grimy atmosphere. As film noir and heist films flourished, the gangster movie archetype pioneered in the 1930s began to fade away. But in the wake of films like The Third Man and The Asphalt Jungle, Warner Brothers would release one major exception. Public Enemy director Raoul Walsh and star James Cagney would re-team for 1949's White Heat. Though the film does contain elements of noir and even the heist film, fundamentally, it's a 1930s gangster movie in terms of its narrative, performance style, and visual aesthetic. But crucially, the film is much more aware that its protagonist is a violent psychopath. Unlike with Tom Powers, who is largely presented as cool and powerful, Walsh highlights that Cody Jarrett is deranged, cruel, and violently unstable. Even the framing of the film steps outside of Jarrett, with much of the narrative told from the perspective of an undercover cop, horrified by Jarrett's actions. The film isn't quite deconstructionist. Jarrett still goes out like the coolest motherfucker ever. Aiden Barr, top of the world! But we do see the cracks in the gangster's facade begin to emerge. Part 3, The New Hollywood Gangster. The next major development in American crime cinema came in 1967, with the production code waning and Hollywood at an identity crisis. It is in this environment that Bonnie and Clyde would emerge to revitalize the gangster film. The film was a return to the classic gangster tropes: rise and fall narrative, outlaw anti-heroes who are anti-authority, the heroes come from a lower class background and achieve a level of glamour and wealth through crime, and the gangsters are ultimately gunned down by the police at the end. But Bonnie and Clyde didn't just redo the same genre cliches of the 1930s gangster movies, it also modernized them. Not only is Bonnie and Clyde way more graphically violent and explicitly sexual than even the boldest of pre-code gangster movies, but the characters are also more psychologically complex. The performances are more nuanced. And the filmmaking techniques, particularly in regard to cinematography and editing, refer to more cutting-edge techniques of European art cinema. Moreover, the gangster archetype was moved to a modern context. Though Bonnie and Clyde is set in the 30s, the characters really reflect the 1960s youth culture, and specifically the cultural divide between the older generation and a disassociated youth who felt stifled by entrenched power structures. Though it took some time to find its audience, Bonnie and Clyde eventually proved a tremendous critical and financial success, helping spark a new era of Hollywood cinema, where younger filmmakers could explore contemporary social concerns while also being more open in their depictions of sex and violence. Two of the most important titles of this era are The Godfather and The Godfather Part II. Like Bonnie and Clyde, The Godfather saga used new Hollywood aesthetics to explore the gangster genre. Once again, we have rise and fall narratives, poverty and immigrant backgrounds, women at the periphery, battles against cops and crooks alike, and a fierce sense of loyalty to family and brotherhood. From riffing on the classic gangster film to full-on remaking them, we come to Brian De Palma's Scarface in 1983. A remake of Howard Hawks' film, De Palma sticks very close to the original in terms of narrative structure. A young immigrant named Tony struggles in American poverty before turning to a life of crime. Tony first serves under a mafia boss, but his ambitions grow too large, flirting with danger and the boss's wife. The boss attempts to have Tony assassinated, but with help from his friends, Tony kills his boss and consolidates power as the major crime boss of the city. Soon after building his empire, it begins to crumble. As the cops close in, Tony becomes increasingly paranoid, culminating in the murder of his best friend when Tony catches him with his sister. Soon after, Tony's enemies close in, and he is ruthlessly gunned down before both films end on virtually the same shot. So in all three of these films, we see the classic gangster film recontextualized in modern filmmaking techniques. Crucially though, while these films do recreate the traditional gangster film narrative and archetype, they also begin to deconstruct the gangster mythology. Let's take a look at these movies again. Bonnie and Clyde presents Clyde as impotent, undercutting the romantic mythology of he and Bonnie, but also creating a character flaw which strikes deeply at male insecurities. Clyde's relationship to his brother is also a shallow one. Despite their loyalty to each other, the two men don't really have anything in common, or anything meaningful to say to each other. Also, despite the gang's successes throughout the film, they never truly ascend economically. While the 30s gangster was able to enjoy wealth and capital, Bonnie and Clyde spend all of their movie living in squalor. The monetary gain of the gangster lifestyle isn't quite as attractive in this vision. The rise and fall is a fundamental aspect of the gangster movie, but it's only with The Godfather that the rise is the fall. Michael's ascent in the criminal underworld is the cause of his moral degradation, resulting in a twisted and cruel man left completely alone. Really, Michael's fall comes not at the end of the saga, but near the beginning, when he decides to murder Sollozzo and McCluskey. In making that choice, Michael commits to an immoral life, one which will alienate him from everyone he loves. The sense of family that pervades The Godfather is revealed to be fragile. The loyalty to a brotherhood of the classic gangster crumbles, with Michael destroying his relationships with Tom and Fredo, culminating in this image of Michael abandoned by his brothers. Also in shambles is the gangster's relationship to women. In the classic gangster film, women were relegated to secondary roles, but in The Godfather, we see women resist this trope. The days of women like Carmela passively accepting their husband's every decision and dutifully performing domestic chores are coming to an end. Kay questions Michael. She resists the confines he places her in, acts on her own interests even when it opposes his, and eventually, she leaves Michael. Connie too resists the rigid gender roles placed on her, and by the time of Part 3, is implied to have taken a much more active role in the family business. Where the classic gangster films took this gender divide for granted, The Godfather sees palpable tension. This tension carries into De Palma's Scarface. Where Poppy largely disappears from the original after hooking up with Tony, Elvira is much more present. Her story doesn't just end once she's been won by Tony. Elvira comes to learn that for all Tony's bluster and flash, he's ultimately boring.
Boring? What's boring?
You're boring.
Oh.
And on learning this, Elvira takes action. She leaves Tony. No longer simply a prize for the gangster, the Moll has a life of her own. And then there's Tony's sister. The original Scarface does hint at a potentially uncomfortable aspect to Tony's overprotection of his sister, But De Palma's film makes it explicit that Tony's attitude stems from a perverse sexual attraction towards his sister. This really helps move the needle away from the gangster is cool to the gangster is unstable, perverse, and disturbed. There's shades of Cody Jarrett here, who also had a perverse sexual attraction towards a family member. In the wake of New Hollywood, filmmakers returned to and complicated the traditional gangster archetype, examining the consequences of organized crime and offering a more sobering look at the gangster himself. But here's the thing. All three of these films ultimately reify the allure of the gangster myth. Bonnie and Clyde are presented as Robin Hood-esque folk heroes who rob from the rich during the Dust Bowl. The economic anxiety of the time is emphasized when the pair meet some poor farmers who had their home foreclosed on, with the implication being that the outlaw criminal duo, they aren't the real bad guys. As characters, Bonnie and Clyde also spoke to a 60s counterculture mistrustful of authority. They were heroes to the youth movement of the 60s. Clyde may have been impotent, but the film is still highly erotic through its visuals and editing. The film implies a sexual liberation, even if it isn't technically on screen. Plus, Bonnie and Clyde do make love before being gunned down, adding a romantic charge to their final blaze of glory. And speaking of blazes of glory, though the text may suggest a crime doesn't pay message, the cinematic framing of Scarface is entirely glamorized. From the indulgent cinematography, to the montage editing, to the opulent production design, to the bumping pop music. Everything denotes that Tony Montana is a badass. Bloodily gunning down some thugs? Badass. Cruising through sunbathed Miami in style? Badass. Money counting montage? Badass. Owning a tiger? Badass. Wanting to fuck your own sister? That one's not great. And of course, there's the climactic shootout. Tony may suffer a grisly and painful end, but there's also a certain escapism in watching Tony defiantly facing down his enemies, despite impossible odds. This is in fact the most substantial change in adaptation. The original Scarface ends with Tony Camonte begging forgiveness, then cowardly attempting to flee before being shot in the back. Tony Montana ain't having any of that shit. This Tony refuses to accept defeat, instead grabbing a big-ass gun and mowing down as many motherfuckers as he can. Tony even absorbs a superhuman number of bullets before finally being brought down. The return of The World Is Yours may be read as an ironic device emphasizing all Tony has lost, but it may also be an affirmation of his own awesomeness. Sure, Tony may be dead, but he also rose to the top in style, got to live like a king, and went out like a real man. I'm just saying, there's a reason Scarface has been so often reinterpreted as a macho power fantasy. If you look deeper, you can see the holes. That beneath Tony's charm and bravado, there's ultimately nothing. That nothing he does brings him real happiness, and that his choices destroy everything good in his life. But that gleaming surface of excess and indulgence can be overwhelmingly seductive. In this regard, The Godfather might seem an exception. Part 2 in particular really stews in a sense of misery and loss, as Michael slowly alienates himself from everyone he loves. The final image of Michael Corleone is not a ballet of bullets and rebellious spirit, but a broken man sitting alone on a park bench. Instead, The Godfather's myth-making comes from its framing and the implication of what once was.
And we was like the Roman Empire. The Corleone family was like the Roman Empire.
It was once.
The Godfather Part 2 juxtaposes Michael's fall with the rise of the Corleone family in the 1920s, the implication being the early years were the glory days of the family. While the main story is of fractured characters irrefutably separated and defined by dark lighting, the flashback images of family unity, bathed in nostalgia and warm golden browns. The gangster lifestyle may have soured, but it was good once. There's also the contrast between Michael and his father Vito. A common reading of the saga is that while Michael built his empire on fear, intimidation, and power, Vito built his on honor, respect, and nobility. In short, Vito did things the right way, and Michael didn't. Now I should pause for a second to say that I personally really disagree with this reading, for reasons I may go into in another video. But it is a common reading which draws on evidence from the text, so it's worth taking seriously. In both old age and in youth, Coppola does present Vito with a certain reverence, this noble and wise father figure, who both Brando and De Niro play with a certain gentleness, yet still imply a stern authority. The end result is a character who is strong and powerful, but also honest and even kind. Michael, by contrast, is cold, withdrawn, and increasingly throughout part two, cruel. So this notion of Vito the good gangster and Michael the bad gangster does hold some validity, and this maintains the romantic image of the gangster archetype. It's not that the gangster is bad, but that Michael is. And even then, Michael isn't really a villain, or at least, he didn't start as one. Michael starts the trilogy as a good man, a young college boy and patriot, kind-hearted, loving, and with clear ambitions to live an honest life. But circumstances thrust him into the role of a crime boss. He didn't want this life, he inherited it, and he did the best he could with the hand he was dealt. Maybe his choices weren't always good, but he isn't really a bad guy. And this sense of not really being the bad guy echoes through all three of these films. Bonnie and Clyde weren't really villains, they were romantic outlaws and youthful rebels who stuck it to the man. Even the gleefully amoral Tony Montana demonstrates a moral compass.
You think I killed two kids and a woman? Fuck that! I don't need that shit in my life.
See, he's not that bad. So in the new Hollywood gangster film, we see the cracks in the gangster facade coming to light, but the myth is largely maintained, thanks to a level of glamorization and moral integrity. Part 4. Once Upon a Time in America. Before Bonnie and Clyde even hit theaters, Sergio Leone was conceiving Once Upon a Time in America. Following the success of his Dollars trilogy, Leone set his sights on adapting James Gray's true-ish account of the gangster lifestyle, The Hoods. Though described as an authentic look at the mafia during Prohibition, Leone was struck by how much Gray's stories resembled those of the old gangster movies, and saw an opportunity to comment on the tropes of the gangster film. Of course, Leone was not done with the Western, and would be put off The Hoods by Duck, You Sucker, and some other Western for Paramount, I don't know. Even when those projects were finished, though, it took Leone more than a decade to actually bring The Hoods to the screen. It was not until 1984 that Once Upon a Time in America finally hit theaters, post-Bonnie and Clyde, post-Scarface, and post The Godfather. And it was the very cinematic texts these movies were built on that Leone was about to destroy. On the surface, Once Upon a Time in America seems just as romanticized as the gangster films of the new Hollywood. The flashbacks to the character's childhood echoes the good old days framing of The Godfather Part 2, with the cinematography stressing these romantic golden hues, resulting in some of the most beautiful imagery in any gangster film. Crucial too is the casting of Robert De Niro, an actor not only associated with the most noble of all movie gangsters, but also someone who exudes a certain sympathy. Even when playing utterly despicable people, there's a vulnerability to De Niro that helps audiences latch onto him. At his most monstrous, he's always human. Finally, the film is wrapped in a rich and gentle score from Ennio Morricone. The music is poetic, warm, and with a hint of romantic longing. Indeed, Once Upon a Time in America's presentation all suggests a deep sense of romanticism. But if you've seen the film, you know that something about this reading is troubling.
No trouble.
There's nothing romantic about these guys. The gangsters of Once Upon a Time in America are not youthful rebels, or tragic figures, or fulfilling power fantasies. They're cruel and vindictive monsters, purely concerned with their own desires and who delight in humiliating others. And yet, for all their selfishness, their lives are repeatedly proven to be empty and unfulfilled. In other words, these people are not good, and nothing about their lives is desirable. The film builds these hateful characters and their stories through the major archetypes of the American gangster film, but the narrative is constructed in a way which undercuts the romanticism or nobility. Let's go through the tropes point by point. Immigrants from the lower class. The central gang in Once Upon a Time in America are Jewish immigrants we see living in ghettos as children. So theoretically, this is the classic gangster setup, where the impoverished rise out of poverty and remake themselves as wealthy, successful, and strong. Except we never actually see this rise. Noodles goes to prison as a teen, and by the time he's released, Max and the gang have already ascended from poverty and built a sizable empire for themselves. Meaning the film minimizes the rags-to-riches narrative, and instead emphasizes the gangster's greed and cruelty. It's not about making a better life, it's about taking everything you want for yourself. This is symbolized in an early scene, where young Dominic buys a dessert to trade to local girl Peggy in exchange for sex. As he waits, Dominic begins to eat it himself, starting slowly, but before long devouring everything while Morricone's score swells in delight. Why share anything when you can take it all for yourself? This seemingly innocent moment establishes the selfishness which will define this gang. Battles against the cops and rival gangs. This does technically occur in Once Upon a Time in America, but the struggle is very one-sided. After the childhood flashbacks, it never really feels like the gang is under threat. They dispatch with other gangsters with relative ease, and the one cop who stands against them is quickly put in his place. A fear of prison does lead Noodles to move against Max, but this is driven more by hubris than any genuine threat, and is later revealed to be a scheme from Max in the first place. Compare that to The Godfather, where the film stresses the Corleone family's vulnerability after Vito was shot. For a film about a powerful crime family, the Corleone spend a great deal of the runtime under the gun, struggling against their many enemies and suffering devastating losses. For Noodles, such vulnerability only exists as a child and an old man. But in the peak of his success, he and his gang were bullies, easily crushing and humiliating all who stood against them. The gang is a boys' club. Gangster movies rarely depict women in a dignified way, but I don't know of any gangster film that is as cruel towards women as Once Upon a Time in America. Most every woman in the film is subjected to heinous violence, and all are reduced to sex objects. Even this dialogueless extra, who only appears for a few seconds, is both sexually objectified and violently threatened. But this callous treatment does not go unobserved. The film draws a parallel between the gang's abhorrent treatment of women as adults to their adolescent encounters with women as teens. As Leone scholar Christopher Frayling argues, the gang are all emotionally stunted, quote, like small boys obsessed with their equipment, who have no idea how to relate to flesh and blood women. In other words, the misogyny of Noodles and the others is not unknowing and it's not celebrated, but a defining character flaw. Moreover, Once Upon a Time in America foregrounds the consequences of the men's cruelty. When Max berates and humiliates Carol in a gang meeting, Leone spends a lot of time foregrounding this humiliation, resulting in an awkward and painfully uncomfortable scene. Noodles' girlfriend, a completely superfluous character who only exists as a trophy for Noodles, is brutally killed in the film's opening minutes. Noodles may completely disregard her, but the film still takes the time to see how his choices cause her harm. Finally, I have to talk about the relationship between Noodles and Deborah. Content warning, this section will involve discussing sexual violence, and will include footage of a rape scene from the film, though I will try to minimize any explicitly violent images. If you'd like to skip this section, click the timecode in the description. The film's flashbacks quickly reveal that from a young age, Noodles fixated on and lusted after Deborah. This is most emphasized by Noodles spying on Deborah's dancing, able to voyeuristically engage with her, but unable to build any meaningful relationship. This objectification continues into adulthood, when Noodles continues to struggle with genuine intimacy and proceeds to rape Deborah in the back of a limo. Leone had depicted rape in prior films, but always with a certain eroticism. From fetishized shots of women's bodies to the emphasis on male pleasure, these scenes, whether intentionally or not, de-emphasize the violence of sexual assault. Not so in Once Upon a Time in America. This scene is brutal, it's messy, and it's extremely uncomfortable to sit through. Any lingering notion that Noodles is anything more than a cruel and self-centered creep is shattered here. Also crucial is the long, painful aftermath, with Leone forcing both Noodles and the audience to take in the aftermath of the violence without cutting. Again, Leone is emphasizing the horrific consequences of the gangster's violent actions. Violent actions, which bring no real joy. The scene following Deborah's rape is among the film's most pitiful, with a drunken Noodles paying a prostitute to pretend to be Deborah so he can make believe they have any sort of intimacy. This is an important follow-up to the rape scene, as it demonstrates that beneath Noodles' violence is a pathetic and lonely figure. This does not justify his actions or elicit sympathy. Rather, it emphasizes the futility of his violence, that it brings him no peace. Loyalty to a brotherhood. One thing Once Upon a Time in America stresses even more than most gangster films is the sense of brotherhood loyalty. The central gang are childhood friends who made a pledge as boys to always be together and to share in their riches. This pledge will be shattered by Max, who devises an elaborate plot to have all his friends killed, trick Noodles into thinking he was responsible, then abscond with their shared loot. Brotherhood, it turns out, is worth a hell of a lot less to the gangster than personal enrichment. Noodles learns all this in the twilight of his life. Now a small and lonely old man with little to live for, Noodles returns to New York, where Max explains that after orchestrating the murder of their friends, Max used the stolen money to reestablish himself as Secretary Bailey, a wealthy American businessman and politician. Not only did he build a fortune, but Max also married Deborah, and the two have a son together. In turn, Max not only betrayed Noodles, but also stole the life Noodles always wanted for himself.
I took away your whole life from you. I've been living in your place. I took your money. I took your girl. All I left for you was 35 years of grief over having killed me.
But Noodles doesn't react with anger. Instead, he chooses to live in the myth. Noodles continues to refer to Max as Secretary Bailey, maintaining that Max died with the rest of his friends 30 years ago. Noodles knows this is false. He knows that his best friend betrayed him, and that their history was largely built on bullshit. But that truth is too painful. So instead, Noodles chooses to embrace the myth. This speaks to Once Upon a Time in America's meta-commentary on the cinematic gangster. The film thoroughly dismantles the notion of a glamorized or romanticized gangster myth. But with Noodles' rejection of reality, Leone also demonstrates why such myths are attractive in the first place. This also ties in with the film's ending. Rather than closing on an elderly and totally alone Noodles, the film returns to the man in the 1930s, retreating to an opium den and getting high. This has sparked debate that large portions of the film are actually a drug-induced hallucination, but I think that misses the point. Metaphorically, this scene captures the ethos of the whole film and the very appeal of gangster movies. Unable to accept the harshness of reality, Noodles escapes into fantasy. We all love a good illusion, after all. Part 5, The Death of the Gangster. Just as we rarely see the John Wayne-style simplistic cowboy of Stagecoach in a post-Leone world, likewise with the American gangster. Noodles may not die at the end of Once Upon a Time in America, but Leone's depiction is so scathing that he eviscerated the gangster far more effectively than any death scene ever could. The gangster lives, but only to be tortured by guilt for the pain they've caused. In exposing the levels of cruelty, misogyny, and greed which underlie the gangster archetype, while also removing the romanticism associated with the genre, Sergio Leone effectively killed the traditional gangster movie. Of course, the fact that Once Upon a Time in America was cut down to a confusing mess by the Ladd Company, met by dismal reviews from critics who couldn't make sense of the new version, and ate shit at the box office, well, that likely also contributed to the decline of the traditional gangster movie. We still see gangster movies, of course, but most step away from the archetype laid out in the 1930s. The most influential gangster film of the last 30 years is most certainly Goodfellas, but that film shied away from wealthy mob bosses and foregrounded a more working-class criminal, an approach The Sopranos would follow through with. A similar ethos informs Pulp Fiction, which is certainly more romanticized than Goodfellas, but also concerns itself with more low-scale problems rather than the grand narratives of old. And as Scorsese has returned to his Goodfellas formula, he's moved further and further away from street criminals and move towards the more legitimate world of corporate crime. Another trend to emerge is an equal or sometimes greater focus on the cops hunting the crooks as the crooks themselves. This trope was re-energized by Brian De Palma's The Untouchables, and still echoes through today. Case in point, the most recent cinematic take on Bonnie and Clyde is all about the cops who took down the iconic duo, rather than the duo themselves. Then you have modern heist and con movies, crime movies which focus more on a specific job than an overarching epic crime narrative. The gangster movies of the New Black Cinema of the 1990s, meanwhile, were closer to socio-political critiques of the conditions which pushed young black men into violence and crime, and weren't really riffing on the legacy of the 30s gangster. Now, there are a handful of gangster films post-Leone that do overtly refer to that classic gangster movie, but these films are almost always categorized as throwbacks and aren't really the entries at the forefront of the genre. The big elephant in the room is The Godfather Part 3, which came out 6 years after Once Upon a Time in America. But in that film, you can feel the hangover of Leone's epic. The Michael Corleone of Part 3 is no longer the cunning and ruthless crime boss, but a tired, sad old man, desperately and unsuccessfully trying to salvage something of value from his life. The whole film plays like an extended version of Once Upon a Time in America's flash forwards, with an aging gangster reflecting on his life. Fittingly, Coppola's original title for The Godfather Part 3 was The Death of Michael Corleone. So yes, we still get gangster films, many of them classics in their own right, but the traditional gangster epic created by Warner Brothers in the 1930s died with Once Upon a Time in America. That archetypical gangster may be seductive. He's a rebel, a success, a man of principle, and very powerful. But at the end of the day, he's just a pipe dream.